must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue.
Good morning. Welcome to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I'm your host, Steve Coplon, and thank you for tuning in. Let's have a great day. Good morning, everybody. I hope everybody's having just a wonderful day. Every time I come on the air, that's kind of how I get started. I hope everybody's having a wonderful day. That's a good thought, so let's get that established, that this show is about having good thoughts. In fact, this show is about being able to stimulate your thoughts and then take action. Because thoughts without action, nothing ever changes. And so what I'm here to do, Right Thinking with Steve Coplon, is to hold your interest, entertain you with some things that get you thinking in an enjoyable way so that you want to keep tuning in. And one of the ways that I do that is to bring on guests that I myself love listening to, and I share them with you. And so today we're going to have Dave Richards back on the air in a minute, and it'll be his fifth time on the air. And based on some of the responses I'm getting from you fans, Dave's probably going to have his own show pretty soon if we can talk him into it. So with that said, let me just tell you that I'm going in today's show just a little bit confused. That's nothing new probably for those of you that know me, but what it is while you're listening to this show, I will be traveling around the country on my 8,000-mile trip, going all the way out to Oregon, going through Tulsa, Oklahoma, to spend just a few minutes with Jim Stovall, one of the most incredible human beings that I've ever had the pleasure to be introduced to. Just his Wisdom for Winners series is just incredibly full of wisdom, more than most anything. I've told you all on other shows that I get my greatest influences in my life from the Bible and from Napoleon Hill, but I'm here to tell you that I'm driving 19 hours to have a 15-minute appointment with Jim Stovall because I admire him, and sometimes when you put yourself in the presence of greatness, just a little teeny bit wears off, and I want to meet him personally. And then when you're listening to this show, I'll be out in Oregon, and I'll be at Powder River Correctional Center doing a workshop for the returning citizens out there. And I'm just thankful that Virginia has treated me just so wonderful for 5.5 years that I've been in and out of Virginia prisons. And now I'm going to spread my message all the way out to Oregon. And I thank you all for helping me achieve this. Today's show is going to be a follow-up on the show that I did on July the 10th on choices. And when we bring Dave in a second, I'll just start with Dave on the subject of choices and anything that he wants to talk about. I always like to start the show with some scripture, just to sort of set a tone. And the scripture that I used the other day, Matthew, I think it was chapter 14. I don't remember the exact reference. I'll come up with that eventually. But the idea is that it was about Peter stepping out of the boat. And, you know, my wife is my spiritual mentor here. She's my partner in coming up with the themes for the show and what we want to do with it. It's Matthew 14, verse 25, I think it is, that we're going to. And it's a story that I told about Jesus had just finished, and he was up on the mountain, and he told all the disciples to go out on the boat. And then in the middle of the night, they thought they saw a ghost, an apparition, and they saw something, and it was kind of like through a fog, and it was Jesus walking on the water. And Peter said, "If that's you, tell me to get out of the boat." I told this story on that show on July the 10th, but after I told it, the story basically is he got out of the boat. Jesus just said, "Come." When Peter said, like he always is doing, you know, he's almost challenging Jesus sometimes, he said, "Just if that's really you, tell me to get out of the boat and let me have a miracle like you." And so Jesus simply just held his arms up and said, "Come." Peter climbed out of the boat and he started walking on the water. And I want each of you to think about it for a second. How would you feel? Where would your faith be if you were able to walk on the water after Jesus told you to? I think you'd probably move on and have a pretty good life because you'd be obedient for the rest of your life to the Lord. But all of a sudden, he lost his focus on Jesus and he had doubt about what he was doing. And then he started to sink. And Jesus reached down and locked his arm and kept him from drowning. And he looked at him and he said, "Ye of little faith." So I told that the other day about keeping your focus and not having doubt. Well, my wife told me after the show that I did a really good job of relating that story, that parable. But she said, "But there was a main point that I had wanted you to bring out. And your show is on choices. And you left this out, but it was good. It was good, Steve." But I said, "Well, I can make it up on the next show because Dave and I are going to talk about choices." And so here's where I want to pick up on that. Peter had a choice to get out of the boat. He didn't have to get out of the boat. I mean, he told Jesus, "Tell me to get out of the boat." Jesus told him and he got out. But he could have said no. He could have changed his mind. And so herein lies what Donna really wanted me to try to communicate. He had a choice and he took it. And then the rest is the story that I told you. So when we were talking about it today, I said, "Well, sweetheart, tell me what you want me to add to what the lesson here is that we haven't got." And she said, "Well, the lesson is, you know, that he had doubt and that's why he failed, and that you know, you got to overcome your doubt. You got to trust the Lord. That's the real lesson here, is you got to trust the Lord." Well, I said, "Let me take it in just a slightly different direction, because you're exactly right, sweetheart." And so here's what it is. All of us that are afraid to move forward because of previous failures or loss of confidence or whatever, here's the lesson when Peter made the choice to get out of the boat. You could say that he failed because he sank, because he had doubt. And somebody could say, "Hey, why should I do it again? You know, I tried and I failed." He did not fail. He did not fail. He did not drown. Jesus kept him from drowning. Jesus was proud of him because he took that first step out of the boat. We all have to take the first step. I'm on Talk Network Radio with Jeff Heiser, and that's his slogan. You know, you've got to take the first step. Well, Peter took the first step. If he hadn't gotten out of the boat, the whole Bible would have been different with Bible stories, because Peter wouldn't have been the guy that was leading everybody into following the Lord. So here's what I want to tell you. Do not be afraid to get started, even if you fall. If you don't try, you'll never get there. And so Peter tried. There's a couple real simple phrases that I want to give you about what he did. This is completely what we call secular. If at first you don't succeed, then try again. Okay. Perseverance. That's my forte. I teach perseverance. Here's another one. Never ventured, never gained. If you don't try, you're not going to have a chance. And I do not support, and I'm sorry, state of Virginia, because I don't gamble. I don't support the lottery myself. And I know a lot of people are addicted to it, and they support it, and it pays for a lot of education, a lot of roads, so I guess it's a good government thing. But if you don't buy a ticket, you won't win. So that's kind of where I'm going to start today, and in a second I'm going to bring Dave in. But for those of you that don't know Dave Richards, Dave Richards is, I always say, he's a wonderful person. He's a humanitarian. He's a wise man. He's got a calm personality. He's a leader. He's a head of a very large organization. He thinks very abstract, very large. He doesn't get bogged down in the details. He knows how to manage. He's a man that's worth listening to. In my 5.5 years with Dave, I've had just incredibly good, positive experiences that he's been there to share with me. He was my first member to be on my board. He's an advisory board member. He's connected me with many people. So you need to go back, if you haven't listened to any of the shows that Dave's been a part of, and listen to them, because it will help you. So With that said, I have said good morning. I've corrected myself for failing to deliver the message that Donna asked me to last week. So sweetheart, I hope that I've redeemed myself with you. Thanks for giving me a second chance. And with that said, good morning, Dave. How are you today?
Steve, I'm fine. So on the topic of choices, it appears to me that you had a choice. You could have not brought up the subject at all and totally, completely disappointed your wife, or you could make the smart choice and do what you just did. So you were obviously a very wise man.
I told you Dave was wise. He just told every man listening, listen to your wife. And the best way you can do that, Dave, and I think Dave might have taught me this, listen to this and memorize it. No matter what the question is, yes, dear, you're right.
Yeah, we'll veer from that subject. Yes, that's a good one. Anyways, it's a pleasure to be here on the air with Steve. And the other times we've done this, I've generally been in a totally different area, a different town when we've been on the air talking. And this time when we're doing the show, we're sitting next to each other on recording this. So this is kind of fun. I get to look at Steve while he goes forth. So anyways.
That's a good observation, Dave. Thanks for pointing that out. We got another show that we're doing while I'm traveling. And in the future, we're making a lot of progress. And I use myself as kind of a living example of someone that is going through hard times. And I keep persevering. But I want to tell all of you, I know that on a lot of my shows I talk about I've made a lot of really bad decisions, and it's taken me a long time to get my life in the right order. I want to clarify something. I do believe that I've had a wonderful life, that I've had a lot of great success. And when I allude to the fact that I've made a lot of decisions and taken a lot of side roads, so to speak, I set my goal when I was just 16 years old. I turned 66 a couple weeks ago. And you're listening to somebody that has been on the same direction, the same path for over 50 years now, because I've always wanted to be a writer, a motivational speaker, an encourager, and I just go with life. But one thing that I want to tell you, and I'm going to turn it back over to Dave because I think he's going to have some thoughts on what I'm going to say. My father, when I was young, he used to tell me that I'm doing too many things without enough savings. I'm not dedicating enough of my earnings into saving for a rainy day, for the future, for something like that. And he told me that I should do more of that because someday something might happen and I'm not going to have the ability to earn the income, and it could affect me if I'm not more stable with my finances. Well, my dad's 94, August the 4th. It might actually be the week that this show airs, but my dad was right. I have been a very successful, strive to be a godly person my whole life, but I have made a few detours. But the thing I want to tell you right now is that, bless you, Dave.
Excuse me.
The thing that I want to tell you is that I did not spend enough time. I lived too much for the moment, too much, too often. And then I had very serious health issues a couple times, and it's been very hard to overcome that. But I'm in the right direction, and I do not consider myself a failure at all. But what's affected me is unforeseen circumstances that I might not have been properly prepared for. And I never quit. I never will. My slogan's don't quit, plan ahead, it'll get better. So I'm not kicking myself too hard. A lot of things that I've gone through are out of my control. Dave, you listened to the show on choices. Anything that you that stood out in your mind that you'd like to continue?
Boy, the topic of choices, I mean, you know, we could talk about this for hours and hours and hours, and I think we could share examples in our lives. So I'm a few years younger than Steve, but not that much younger. And so I can point to 10, 15, 20 great examples of people that have made everyday choices that have profoundly affected their lives. And as I've raised, or my wife and I have raised our kids, I'll give her more of the credit than me, we give examples of people that make choices, both good and bad. You can point to choices that people make that was a great choice, and then you can point to those that you say, boy, that was a really bad choice. A good person who just made a really bad choice, and hopefully they picked themselves up and moved on. So, and just kind of thinking through today's show, I've just thought back to a number of those people that I know and everyday people who made fundamental choices to affect their lives and stuck with them and have had and have good lives. And again, I think that's what when Steve said we're going to talk about choices today, and would you listen to the last week's show, which I have. I think it's just a great, great subject, and there's inspiration everywhere. There's inspiration maybe from this show for people listening. There's inspiration in, you know, the biographies of great men and women, and there's just inspiration everywhere. There's inspiration in the Bible. So reading and learning about choices can fundamentally affect your life. This is not an academic subject. This is real life.
That's beautiful. I want to share a compliment. I'm very free with compliments, by the way, that are sincere and from the heart. A lot of people say I, you know, am too nice to people. No, not that many people say that, I guess. But I want to give Dave a compliment. I've got a proverb here that applies to Dave. Proverb 27. A righteous man who walks in his integrity, how blessed are his sons after him. Dave and his wife, Janie, have two amazing sons, and they are as fine young men that I've ever come across. And you've all heard an expression, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. And Dave has passed on some absolutely wonderful, wonderful character traits to his sons, and they share a lot of his wisdom. So, Dave, congratulations on being such a fine father.
Well, thank you, Steve, and I'll share the compliment back. I know your boys, I've met your boys, and have known them for years, and they're, again, wonderful young men who are, you know, doing the same thing, finding their path forward. So, how would you like to proceed? Steve, it's your show. I've got a bunch of thoughts. A couple stories literally jump to mind around choices. And so one of my best friends, who I respect as much as anybody, is an interesting case. He's again about my age, so a little bit less than 60. African American, raised by his grandparents, very modest means, in Atlanta, and has an older brother who's slightly older than him, a year or so older, and they went fundamentally different directions in their lives. And Mike is my friend, and I asked Mike, you know, what was it, you know, that caused you to go this direction and your brother to go that direction? And Mike said, as a young man, he saw men and women wearing uniforms. He said that impacted him. He saw those as symbols of a decent life, of a good life, of whatever. And he's a very active member of his church. And that simple image, that symbol, caused him to go down a path where it led him to join junior ROTC. And then he ended up going to, I think he went to Georgia Tech. He's an engineering degree at Georgia Tech, which is obviously a very fine school. And then he got out and went into the Marine Corps as an officer. He served 4 years as an officer in the Marine Corps. And then he got out and got his JD MBA, his Juris Doctoris, and his Master's of Business from the University of Virginia. And he just kept going on and on and on. And he's had a very successful life. Now he's had failures and setbacks, as we all have. And his brother went a very different path and made some decisions early on, and had a very, very different life. And I don't know much about his brother. I'm sure he's a fine person. And that's, to me, and again, because they both came from the same setting. They both were raised by the same set of grandparents, and very, very fundamental decisions change their lives. And the nice thing about decisions, and this goes back to this your point, Steve, about mistakes and errors and all that, is everybody makes them. We all do. Some people never get over them, and they carry them along as baggage. Other people accept them and say, yep, messed up there. I learned something, and I'm now going to go forward. I'm going to make a new set of decisions. And there's no one that's walked on this earth, and I'm not a biblical scholar, so maybe Jesus falls into this one category, or Muhammad, or Buddha, or somebody. But there's nobody that walks on this earth who hasn't made mistakes. Many, many, many mistakes. We all do. Hopefully, the healthier you are, the more you move on from them. You accept the learnings, and you accept the lesson you were meant to learn, and you make a better decision going forward and try not to make the same one twice.
That's a lot of good reflections there. You know, you make me think, one of the things that I've been dealing with over the course of Right Thinking Foundation's 5.5 years going in and out of correctional facilities and in my life also, it's that we meet a lot of people that have different beliefs. A lot of people have different beliefs in their faith. And, you know, religious freedom on my July the 4th celebration show, I gave a little history, and I talked about how that was the prime reason why our original 13 colonies, I think almost every one of them was for religious freedom, except for Georgia, which was a penal colony. But, you know, we're a very accepting, tolerant society here. So I just want to establish something here. In my program in the very beginning, when I went into prisons, it was Powhatan Correctional, one of the oldest correctional facilities in the state of Virginia. It was closed about 2 years ago, and I had a lot of wonderful experiences there where I really got into working with the population of returning citizens. I was talking one day there, and I referenced the Youngbloods, a 1967 song that just came out while I was talking. It just sort of, come on, people, now smile on your brother. Everybody get together. Try to love one another right now. You know, love is a universal thing, and what I'm here to tell you is that I've established this, and I want to repeat it because for those of you that are listening to the show, that some of you might not share the same testimony that I share, I want you to know this, and this is what I've done for 5.5 years while I'm in prisons. I love everybody. I love Venetians, Martians, Neptunians. I want to go all the way out to the universals there. And then when you come in, I love everybody on this planet. I love everybody. You know, name every color you want to. But what I'm trying to tell you is I love every religion. So please do not be offended. The universal truths that I had a pastor heard one of my shows, and you know, as much as I quote Bible scripture, he said, well, you use the term universal truths, and that offended a pastor. Well, I'm sorry, pastor. These are universal truths. Loving your brother, serving others. Now, it doesn't matter what persuasion you are. That's a good way to go. And if I reference biblical references, I could just as easily reference other things from other religions that I've studied. I studied Zen Buddhism and many other forms while I was in college, and I love world religions. But religion is no more than just trying to find a way to approach this life. That's kind of what religions are all about. So, Dave, I just wanted to throw that in because sometimes I feel like some of our listeners, they might be, and what you said was correct. You know, we're here for everybody. So no matter who you are, I want to try to help make your life better by getting you unstuck. Now, Dave, when I talked on the show on choices, it's been a couple weeks ago when this is going to air. Viktor Frankl is one of the greatest people that's ever gotten into the subject of choices. And his most powerful quote on choices is, the last of the human freedoms is to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances. People listen to Viktor Frankl because he went through the most horrific experiences that I think anybody on the face of this earth could go through. The Nazi concentration camps where everybody died in his family but his sister, his wife, a brother, his parents. And he suffered. But he learned a lot about the meaning of life, and he's passing on to others. What'd you think about Viktor Frankl? Are you much familiar with Viktor Frankl?
Yeah, a little bit. Sure. Powerful. I think those are incredibly powerful thoughts. It really made me think about this notion of optimism versus pessimism. And you really can, I find this interesting. People that are, quote, pessimists say, no, I'm not a pessimist, I'm a realist. This is my own personal feeling, I think that's bunk. Optimists are realists as well. They just see the world and believe that you can achieve things. And an optimist sees as many roadblocks and stumbles, possibilities, as a pessimist. They just choose to kind of go that way. And my experience, Frankl's insights from, living through the concentration camps and all that is, I think, is just remarkable insights. I'm thinking about I can't remember who the quote was, but I really enjoyed it. Maybe it was Churchill. Someone said to Churchill, "You seem to be an optimist, or an eternal optimist." And his comment was basically, yeah, there doesn't seem to be any logic in anything else. I mean, that's the only way to live. And similar to that, his comment was, if after, the end of the day, my optimism was misguided, 30 years later, I was optimistic that something good would happen, and 30 years later, nothing good happened. His comment was basically, well, at least I had 30 years of feeling good, as opposed to 30 years of feeling bad.
Yeah, at least you got out of the boat.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, I think Frankl's insights are just something we can all learn from. They're remarkable.
Oh gosh, and going over the quotes that I was trying to present on choices, my favorite one, and a couple of people said, yeah, that's probably just one of the best ones that you did, Steve, was Henry Ford. If you think you can, or you think you can't, you're right. That is so profound. I mean, think about what Viktor Frankl says, that we have a choice to have our own attitude in any circumstance, to control our attitude. Henry Ford says, if your attitude towards something is that you're going to fail, then you probably are going to fail. But if your attitude is that you're going to succeed, then you probably are going to succeed. So, what's wonderful about this field of motivation and getting people encouraged by giving them examples of historical figures that have done well and persevered and overcome obstacles, they're good stories. But I'm always coming back to ground zero, where somebody is all pumped up, gets all excited, and then they go out, and then they get beat to death, knocked down, turned down, rejected, and they're like, I tried. So Dave, let me give you that one. That's one of my themes. I'm 24 or 5 shows out now, but that's one of the themes that I'm always trying to get to, is I got a heart for people that are the downtrodden, that just lost their confidence. You met Johnny. For those of you listening, we have a friend, Johnny Thomas, that's a man that I met at the YMCA came to me because I gave him a Napoleon Hill book, Outwitting the Devil, and it changed his life. And I interviewed him on a show. Go back and see the interview with Johnny Thomas. Dave and Johnny and I were at a coffee shop in downtown Norfolk where I introduced Dave to Johnny. And Johnny is an impressive guy, but he acknowledged that he had lost his spark. He was like a recluse. He didn't work for a year. Well, he's working for 3 months now, making good money, paid back a loan or two that I helped him with to get some clothes and to buy a computer. And I'm just so proud of Johnny. So people that have lost their spark, Dave, all this wonderful, positive, upbeat motivation, I think I can answer part of my question that I want you to expand on it and tell some more stories. I'll go silent for a while here because I want to share you more than I'm allowing you to speak right now. I apologize for that. What it is this. I've learned something in the last couple months by doing this show. I've always been a little not sure of how I can really get people to take action even when they're motivated and stimulated. Well, I think it takes a whole network of people here, a whole team. And I want to throw a thank you out to Chuck Christie, who's given us the production capability to be on the show now. And as a little announcement, we're going to have tremendous things coming in the next months or so, where Chuck is going to give us the capability, and Dave's Connect platform, that's the website platform that he donates to Right Thinking, we're going to be able to post videos, Vimeo, YouTube type things, where we can address certain topics that we're talking about and really get further into it. So I encourage all the listeners, this is part of the answer, I guess. Each one of us has a way to contribute something, and it's usually different. Dave's got much that he's contributing. He contributes the website, the technology. Chuck is contributing production capability. But if you join rightthink.org, if you go to rightthink.org, www.rightthink.org, and then you can register into the Right Think website, you will be a member, so to speak. You're not going to get solicited in any way, but you will have the ability to contact me. And if you like Dave Richards, I can connect you with Dave Richards on the internet. And we can all start to form support groups. So what I'm getting at is, these pastors that I've often said, well, they get them all spiritually ready, believing what they need to do and trusting the Lord, which is a fundamental. But are they given tools? Well, maybe they're not supposed to be the ones that give the tools. Maybe it's somebody like me that heard a pastor that got motivated that wants to, in other words, pass it on. So, Dave, I'm going to pass it on to you with that theme, is how we connect. Because, Dave, you've got a software platform called Connect, and you are one of the, I'll tell you, for you listeners, it's an international platform. He's got 20 or 30,000 users. States, universities, municipalities all use it. Dave knows how to connect things, and he believes in the power of connecting with one another. So, Dave, teach it to us.
Well, I'm gonna jump back to the first part of your question. You know, what do you say to people that go out there and try and fall down, and you say to them, get back up? And really, Frankl talks a lot about this. He's very frank about it. Basically, he says life is hard. Life is a lot of stumbles. Life is a lot of hurdles to overcome. It's tough. It's challenging. So if you're going in thinking it's going to be easy and whatever, the answer is it's not easy for anybody. It's everybody is fighting this battle. Some have it easier than others, but undoubtedly someone has it worse than you. So I guess I say that. The expectation is, if your expectation is it's going to be easy and you're just going to go out and make huge gains without, you know, struggle and failure, You've got to readjust your mind. And if that sounds harsh, I think it's reality. And I think on one of the very first shows I shared with Steve, a couple of my favorite quotes or passages, and one is by Teddy Roosevelt, and you can go Google this and find it. It's called The Man in the Arena.
Yep.
It's great. I read it at least once a week, maybe some weeks once a day. And there's one of the lines from it, and I'll just read it to you because I think it's great. It's, the credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes up short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming. And there's more. But that's the truth. I mean, the answer is, yeah, the people I admire the most are the people that keep getting up and they keep thinking creatively and they keep figuring out, they got a vision in mind, they know where they're going to try to get to. They're like Steve. Steve wanted to do this 50 years ago, he thought about it. 50 years, he's been working towards this. And now he's here. And that's the pretty common path that successful people do. They just don't give up. Because once you give up, well, that's kind of the end. So the answer is you can't give up. And don't think it's going to be easy. So it can be easy, and good things will come. But you're going to have challenges. And I've said this before, and I believe this. If you happen to live in the United States of America, you have 99% fewer challenges than people that live in 99% of the rest of this world. This is a pretty privileged place. You have the ability to go out and fail. You have the ability to go and succeed. You control so much. The decisions are yours. You're not living in a communist government where they're telling you what to think and what to do. You're in control, and it is your life.
Oh, geez. You know, the stuff we're talking about, Dave, we're all saying the same thing. That's a phrase that I've used over and over again. People that understand what we're talking about, that have made a choice to not quit, not give up, make the most out of the freedom that we have, you get it from many, many different directions, but it's very, very simple. And basically, I think I can reduce it down to just a word or two. Personal responsibility. If we want to take personal responsibility for ourselves, and if the buck stops here, then we ought to learn ways to succeed, surround ourselves with the right people. We got a whole show on that with Don Green from the Pauline Hill Foundation on the Mastermind Group. And you've given advice on one of your shows, Dave, about the importance of working, taking, you know, getting that first job so that you can start to have some independence and success breeds success. So it's almost like preaching to the choir, saying the same thing over again. But when you get right down to it, there's a reason why some people read the same books over and over again, because they're not spiritually mature enough or just mature enough emotionally to see something that's right there in front of them. But if they clear the air, sometimes it's right there. I've told the nerd story a bunch of times. You remember that. And last time I told it, I didn't give the same ending. When the nerd looks in the mirror and he turns to the guy that wants him to go hang out on the street corner, he goes, "No, I don't want to go. I got a job interview tomorrow, and I find that if I get a better night's sleep, I do better in a job interview. And besides, I'm working on my plan. I'm trying to put my budget together. And by the way, that street you want me to go hang on, that's a one-way street going to nowhere. That's a choice that I'm not making anymore." So, Dave, there's a lot of stuff in choices. You told me just yesterday that you think I'm finally finding my sweet spot, hitting my stride, that my message about choices and giving people just motivation on making the better choices, surrounding yourself with the right people, et cetera, and then give them some kind of tool. And the tool starts with taking responsibility for yourself, get a job, pay your bills, honor your commitment. These are the things we talk about every week.
Yes, a couple of thoughts jump to mind. One is I'll tell a short story on one of my sons, actually my older son, and I love both my sons for lots of reasons. But a couple of things that they've done, you just go, wow, they make you proud. And so one of them, my oldest son, when he was, went off to college, and is the very, very first semester. And we're there for parents' weekend. This is first semester freshman year. We're there in October, so he's been there all of a month and a half. And we, you know, he's obviously comfortable. He's got friends, so and all that. And so I said to him, "So what do you think? How do you like, you know, the experience? And you're in college." And he said, "You know, Dad, I don't think I'm going to finish here."
Hmm.
And I went, "Wow."
Yeah.
That then goes, well, talk to me about that. And so he basically said, this is not, and he was doing fine. His grades were fine. But he basically realized that he was in a school that it wasn't, I can't think of a better word, it was too social. It was too much partying, too much. And he found himself, and my son's a very social kid, so this is not a wallflower type kid. He just said, this is not how I picture my life. This is not the group I want to be around. And he said, they're good people. And I said, well, okay, got it. So let's finish the semester out. He was only about a third of the way through. And we spent a lot of money. And so he finished the semester out, did fine academically, and left. And from a, you know, very nice school. And his thought was, I'm going to go. And I thought it was great. He went and lived with his grandmother on a mountaintop, a little house, and went to the local community college for a semester. And he would say to this day, it was the best decision he made to leave, and it was the best decision he made to go to the community college, because all the people there were learning for the right reason.
Mm-hmm.
And so anyways, incredibly proud because he realized the influences around him weren't what he wanted. He made the decision at 18 years old, 19 years old, to get into a different stream, a different group of people around him. And that's it. You've got to get yourself out of bad influences in many cases, if not bad influences, suboptimal influences, and get into it. You have that decision. You can do that today, whether you're 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years old. You have another 20, 30, 40, 50 years ahead of you. Get yourself in with a better set of influences and make the decision to go. And it won't be easy. You may leave some friends behind, but you have that choice. So again, these are very, very practical, everyday decisions that people are making all the time to try to improve their life. And you have that choice to do that.
You know, Dave, you're very fortunate that, was it Bond or Alex that was that?
That was Bond.
Yeah. I know Bond very, very well. I met him when he was about 7 years old. And is he 26? Well, how old is he?
27.
Yeah. So I've known Bond for 20 years. That's how I met Dave. His wife, Janie, was a karate student of mine, and she brought her son, and she liked it so much, and she stayed with it for a couple years. And Dave's never really appreciated me because I trained his wife, and Dave's very humble to his wife all the time because she'll straighten him right out. Well, but that story that Dave just told about, that really wasn't the people he wanted to associate with. Let me say this, if there's any one thing that we all have to do to be successful in life is to, it's our associations, is to be very, very careful about our associations. And, you know, I came along and, you know, I told you I had a lot of detours, and I'm a 60s product, graduated high school in 1969. I went to early rock festivals back then, and, you know, I love the Beatles and things like that. Well, I had a couple really, really close friends, and they're both passed away right now, but they never changed from going in a direction that was not a direction that stable-minded adults that want to make something in their lives ought to do. And so people say, hey, how come you don't hang out with him anymore? I won't even tell you their names, but the point is, I love these guys, but they were going down the wrong path, and I talked to them, and that was their choice. And, you know, I miss them. I don't just miss them because they've passed away. I miss them because after 20, 25 years of close friendship with both these people, I chose not to hang out with them anymore because I just didn't respect their choices. So just remember that. Dave, one of the most profound things that Viktor Frankl said that I brought out in the show on choices, he said that because you have complete control of how you view your attitude in any situation, he said, try this for a way to change, to get yourself to change. Look at yourself as if you were like an old person, like I think 82, 85 years old. Look back at yourself and evaluate whether you're satisfied with what you see. And if you're not, just let that personality die and just start another one. Just go into it. And basically, just start over any time you want. That's what he said. There's nothing stopping you from starting over. So my way of tying all this together is basically, if you can hear people that care about you, that can encourage you, that have wisdom that you respect, and you start to get into their thinking, if you start listening to them, remember this. Even though you think it's going to be the most uphill, difficult journey you've ever attempted, and that you don't think you're man or woman enough to do it, you're wrong. You're wrong. As long as you've got breath in you, you can change. I read a book once, I'll reference it on another show, but it was change yourself and everybody around you. That's a pretty good direction to take. Don't wait for other people to change, blame it on other people. You change. So Dave, in your mind, you have done well with taking responsibility. You know, you've done well. You're a stable person, and that's a compliment. I don't want you to feel bad because I called you stable. I'm just kidding. No, Dave, what are some of your other pointers that we can give people on moving forward and not beating themselves up too much? Just get them started.
The word that jumps to mind, which I really like, is the word care. And I'm going to talk for a couple minutes on that concept. The people that I know that have done really, really well beyond how smart they are or where they came from are people that really care. And so what that means is the way it's reflected is if they are in a job, they care about the job they're doing. It sounds really trite. But they really want to do well in the job. They care about it. I've got software people that work for me, and one in particular is just a brilliant software guy. And the reason is he cares. He doesn't like making mistakes. He doesn't like seeing mistakes. And he really fundamentally cares. And I can think of people that have worked in investment banking and waiting tables. And if there's one common element, it's they really care. So if you then take that, you know, they're actually caring about others. They're caring about themselves, but they're actually caring about others. They're caring about the team they're a part of. They're caring about whatever. But it also goes to themselves. They're quote, caring about their own life. They're taking ownership of it. So to me, if I try to tell, you know, tell or show my own sons that, you know, if you're going to do these jobs, you know, care about it, own it. And if you do that, irrespective of what the job is, you know, cleaning toilets, digging ditches, sweeping streets, if you care about that job and care about doing it well, you will get noticed and you will get ahead. It may not be immediate, but people hire and promote and respect people that care and own these things. And you will literally get ahead. And I would say that about yourself. Care about yourself. And if you're smoking, figure out how to stop smoking. If you're heavier than you want to be, well, care about that and figure out how to take in less carbohydrates and walk more. And so if you apply that word to yourself and take care of yourself and apply it outwardly, care about others more than you care about yourself, I just think that's a great, simple prescription for getting ahead because somehow this stuff comes back to you. It's karma. It's, I don't know what it is, but so.
Very good. So, Dave, we're coming to an end of the show today, and I'd like to just sort of sum up a couple things here. We're building a network, and we thank Chuck Griffin for being part of the team now and bringing us into his team. And in a couple months, we're going to have probably call-in ability where people can call in while we're live. I'm going to be live on the air again on August the 14th. That's after I get back from my trip all the way to the West Coast. And I just want to thank all the listeners for sticking with me. I hope that you're getting something out of these shows. But let me just give you something that can be of value for you. Dave Richards is here for you. I'm here for you. A lot of other people are here for you. And if you take the time to say, you know what, this stuff that these guys are talking about is good. I want more of it. Be an individual. Don't wait for anybody else to do it for you. Contact me through rightthink.org. I've offered it every show, and I'm sincere. Contact me, and we can build a support network that's a private network on our Connect platform where you can express yourself to me. You can ask me questions. We can connect. I can send you links to positive articles. I can give you some positive encouragement, maybe some information that you might like. So take the time to do that. You take that first step to quote Jeff Heiser in the radio show. And I just want to thank you, Dave, for being on the show. And we'll get you on here soon. And God bless you, Dave. And God bless all the listeners. And I'll see you next week.
Thanks for listening to Right Thinking with Steve Copeland. I look forward to being with you again next week. And remember, don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. God bless you and have a great week.